four fighters on stage. We will then open it up for media and fan questions live here at Access, and then we'll take a short break. The combatants will then return for an open workout, and you will have opportunities for one-on-one interviews. So with that backdrop, let's bring out our first two fighters. In a special attraction, two world-class middleweights who have taken decidedly different paths to UFC 148 collide in what many believe could be the fight of the night. Introducing first a knockout artist who challenged Anderson Silva for the middleweight gold back in 2008. With four convincing wins outside the octagon, he has clawed his way back to the Ultimate Fighting Championship and is determined to get back in the title hunt in this, his second UFC stint. 17-7 for his mixed martial arts career with eight wins by knockout, representing Montreal, Quebec, Canada. Please welcome the Predator, Patrick Cote. His opponent is a true to the definition martial artist and one of the most respected fighters in the sport. 9-2 in MMA, he is undefeated as a kickboxer at 17-0 and was an eight-time national champion in Sanshou. One of the most electric strikers in mixed martial arts history, he has a career in Hollywood waiting for him, but says he can't leave the big show without tasting victory inside the octagon. He is one of the most unique and entertaining fighters in the UFC. He is Cung Lee. All right, Patrick Cote, we will start with you. Welcome back, I think, is a good way to start. So what was it like to get the call and the opportunity to replace Rich Franklin in this spot, a huge spot on short notice against Cung Lee?
Oh, it's awesome. You know, I didn't expect to be back in the UFC with a big fight like that, but I think they put me in a big fight like that because they know I'm going to deliver it. You know what? I'm a big fan of Cung Lee. I like his style. I think it's going to be a spectacular fight.
So Rich Franklin, his former opponent, went all the way to Singapore to find sparring partners, felt maybe he could find some guys to mirror Cung Lee's style. Obviously, you didn't have that luxury given you're stepping up here on short notice. What is the biggest challenge in facing such a gifted and unorthodox striker?
Like you said, he's very unorthodox, he's agile, he's tricky, you know, very agile with his legs, good power. So, you know, I don't need to go anywhere. You know, I have all I need in Montreal in my camp. I brought some good softball kicker in my camp, too. So I'm ready. You know, it's a fight. So you never know what's going to happen. But I did my homework for this fight, and I'm ready for this time. I'm ready to give a good fight.
So we know Cung Lee has a flair for the dramatic, huge repertoire of kicks, spectacular finishes. But let's not sell you short here. You're a knockout artist in your own right. You've got one of the best chins we've ever seen in mixed martial arts. Are you coming into this fight prepared to take one, to land one, to make sure you get that W Saturday night?
You know, you can't train a chin. You know, I have a good chin, I know. I'm going to take everything he's going to give me, but I'm going to give him back for sure. And it's going to be a hell of a fight.
And Las Vegas knows you have a good chin. They've installed you as about a 2-1 favorite here. How do you feel about that?
You know, I don't look that. You know, you can be a favorite by a million on paper, but when the bell rings, it's 50-50. It's inside the cage. And, you know, I can't wait to be there Saturday.
All right, Patrick. Doing some French commentary for the UFC. It's good to have you back where you belong inside the octagon. All right, now we get to Cung Lee. Now, it's one thing to throw crazy kicks and spinning stuff. It's another thing to land them. And you do so with remarkable regularity, by the way. For those who don't know, where did you hone your skills and sort of master all of these high-level, difficult strikes?
Well, first of all, I wouldn't consider I'm a master yet, but I started out in Taekwondo and changed over to Sanshou, which is a Chinese-style kickboxing, full contact, which incorporates a lot of kicks and wrestling and sweeps and also punching. So just been training in different styles of martial arts and just keeping an open mind and learning as much as I could.
Now, you've starred in a lot of major motion pictures, you've choreographed fight scenes for other huge movies, but you've said competing in the UFC right now takes priority over everything else, yeah?
Definitely, competing in the UFC is on top of the list, so I started out in martial arts, I love to compete, and I'm going to try to compete as long as I could. Can't fight forever, but I'm going to do as long as I could.
All right, well, to that end, you've won a lot of titles in so many martial arts, kung fu, kickboxing, sansho. You've also tasted MMA glory as the Strikeforce middleweight champion. But to get a win here on this Anderson Silva, Chael Sonnen massive card showcase, how would that accomplishment compare to your other achievements in combat sports?
Being part of UFC was a huge accomplishment, and you know, I'm looking for my first win. It's going to be a very tough fight, very competitive fight against Patrick Cote, and I'm looking forward to it. I'm glad he took the fight on last minute notice, and thank you for that. And you know, fighters get injured all the time, and it's just part of the game. And Rich Franklin pulled out to take over, you know, for Vitor, and now I think this is an exciting matchup for all the fans.
What adjustments did you make, or were you able to make, if any, when the opponent did change from Rich Franklin to Patrick Cote?
Well, it was a big adjustment because Patrick Cote is an orthodox fighter, and Rich Franklin is a southpaw, so definitely big difference. But just changing out my sparring partners and making sure that they come in and they push me hard.
All right, thank you. We will now open it up to media questions for Patrick Cote and Cung Lee. Just raise your hand. We will bring you a microphone, and if you'd be so kind as to stand up when probing the fighters. Thank you.
Hi, Angel Cordero from the MMA Truth in Puerto Rico. Cung Lee, you kind of had a grin when John Anik mentioned that he was up 2-1 as a favorite. What do you think of that?
You know, hey, the odds, it was just a grin. Like I actually liked being the underdog, so I'm happy about that. But it's all about odd, you know, the odd maker. And just like Patrick said, when you step in that cage, it's 50-50. So, you know, when the smoke clears, may the better man stand.
Patrick, you'll challenge the main one half of the main event this Saturday night. What do you think of that matchup?
You know, I think it's Anderson Silva is pretty mad now. It's not a good thing. I'm picking Anderson Silva by the end of the third round. I think it's gonna be very different this time. It's not gonna be surprised by the pace of Chael, but you know, I really hope we're gonna have a good fight. You know, for the main event like that. It's so everybody's waiting for this rematch, and I just hope it's gonna be an amazing fight for the company and for the fans.
Hey Patrick, how are you? This is Rafa from Univision Deportes. Can you talk a little bit about what you do in between fights? Obviously, you keep in shape, but you know, a late notice, late phone call. You love the phone call, but how much of a hurry-up camp do you have, or are you already in shape when you got the phone call?
Well, you know what? For the last 18 months, I fought four times. I won my last four fights. I fought last March 31st in Brazil. Won my knockout in the first round. And I was staying in shape. Yeah, I knew it that I was close to be back in the UFC, and probably this situation could happen, like late replacement or late call. I was staying in shape, and you know, like I said, I fought March 31st. I took 4 days off, got back in the gym. I was already in good shape to fight, and they called me with four weeks before the event, so that was just a bonus for me to have this 4 weeks of training more.
The question here is for both of you. You both are knockout artists. What do you find most challenging about preparing for each other? I guess Patrick first.
Yeah, but you know what? I never fought a guy like Conley before. You know, he's one of a kind. He's very unique. So there's a lot of thing I had to think in my training. And you know, I brought some good guy, like I said, good southpaw kicker. They were doing, you know, this. They were trying to do the style of Conley. It's like when I fought Anderson Silva, you know, they're so different from everybody else. But you know what, I think I did pretty good against Anderson Silva until I bust my knee, and I'm ready to do the same kind of performance without the injury against Cung Lee.
You know, for me, stepping in into the octagon, it's, you know, with 4 ounce gloves, it's always, you know, a game changer. Patrick Cote has very heavy hands, so on top of 4 ounce gloves, you know, just gotta go out there and just leave it all in the cage and not hold back. So that I just train hard, and I'm planning to fight very hard. So I'm looking forward to it.
Thank you.
Peut-être que tu veux parler en français. peut-être nous dire ce à quoi on peut s'attendre pour le combat face à Conley aussi. C'est un message envoyé aux amateurs francophones du UFC. Comment ça se passe ton retour dans l'UFC?
Ça va très bien. Conley, c'est quelqu'un qui est très, très spectaculaire. Un gros combat pour moi. Je reviens sur la carte principale au UFC, donc je suis vraiment, vraiment content et prêt à donner une très bonne performance pour mon retour.
Patrick, can you translate that? Oh, you're ahead of me. I love it.
So she asked me how I felt about my comeback in the UFC and against a dangerous striker again like Conley, and I said I'm just happy to be back on a big show like that on the main card right away. So I'm just happy and give a good show for the fans and for everybody who support me for the last 18 months. They were trying to put me back in the big show, and here I am now.
Hey, Cung. I've got a question for you. The last time we saw you was against Vanderlei, and that was a really, really exciting fight, but you did take some damage, so I'm just curious, how long after that fight, was it before you could get back in there and start training, and did you have to, he was joking. He said he gave you a better nose for movies, but I'm curious, honestly, really, what happened, because you did take some tough punches.
Actually, it's my third broken nose after Vanderlei, so... the second nose job didn't go too good. It was still a little bit crooked. So I actually found a good nose doctor this time around, and he got it pretty, a lot straighter than the other one, until I think I'm done with fighting, then I'll really fix it. But, I think it's pretty straight now. So, hey, thanks, Vanderlei. Hey, I got a free nose job.
Any more questions? Do we see one in the back there? No? Yeah.
Hi, Patrick. Rodrigo del Campo, La Ciudad Deportiva from Mexico. What did you learn in your first stint in the UFC that's going to help you this second time around?
I'm more mature now. I'm doing what I should do maybe 3 or 4 years ago, about my training, about my lifestyle of fighter. Took less time between fights, so I was less injured, and always in good shape. Working a lot of my weakness, and more dedicated about the sport than I was like 3 or 4 years ago. So, you learn by the time, you learn by your mistake. Like I said, I'm doing now what I should do maybe 3 or 4 years ago, but it's never too late. So I'm back now. Can't wait to fight Saturday.
All right, last call for questions for Patrick Cote and Cung Lee.
Question for Cung Lee. In an earlier interview, Mr. Lee, you stated that you are training smarter. Again, no homo, you're looking pretty good, pretty in shape coming into this fight, a lot better, in my opinion, than you went against Vanderlei. Can you break down some of the training or the smarter training that you took up? Thank you.
Basically, fight training is hard on the body. It doesn't matter what age you are. If you overtrain, your body breaks down, you get injured. And, this time around, as soon as I felt like I was getting a little, worn down, I would take it off. Before, my coaches used to always kick me out of the gym. And then, a lot of injuries would happen. My last training camp against Vanderlei, I was always injured, but I was always in the gym. This time around, I actually took better care of my body and made sure that I didn't overtrain.
All right, one more question, anybody? Final question for Patrick Cote and Cung Lee. All right, Patrick Cote, Cung Lee, appreciate your time, fellas. Best of luck Saturday night. All right, now to the co-main event of UFC 148. It is the rubber match of one of the hardest fought series in the modern era. Two former champions will engage one more time for lifetime bragging rights. The fight also marks the final octagon appearance for one of the biggest stars in the promotion's history. Let's get right to it and bring out our co-main eventers. First, we introduce a confirmed UFC legend. He is one of the most principled personalities in the sport, the former and longest reigning light heavyweight champion in UFC history. His UFC career dates back to 1997, and the man has fought the era's best 205-pound icon. Saturday, he will be inducted into the UFC Hall of Fame just 8 hours before the curtain comes down on his exceptional career. Please welcome to the stage for his final press conference as a pro fighter, a fighting icon, Tito Ortiz.
What's up, everyone? Yeah.
All right, now introducing one of the most popular, colorful, and celebrated athletes in all of mixed martial arts. A former police officer from Georgia who 7 years ago sold everything he had to move to Vegas to pursue his dreams in the UFC. He achieved that goal by winning the inaugural season of The Ultimate Fighter and then went on to defeat the likes of Mauricio Shogun, Hua, Quentin Rampage, Jackson, Tito Ortiz, and Rich Franklin. Fighting out of Las Vegas, Nevada, he is the former UFC light heavyweight champion of the world. Please welcome Forrest Griffin. All right, Tito Ortiz, you sit here about 60 hours away from your final UFC appearance. I can't imagine the many things going through your head right now, but at its core, this is still a huge fight for you. Are you able to enjoy what is your final fight week while also keeping your eyes on the prize and the task at hand?
Yeah, I think I did the right work in Big Bear. I did what I needed to do. I'm ready to fight. All that's on my mind right now is to win. It's to go in and perform the way I've never performed before. This is a fight that I wanted. And it's a fight that I'm going to get. It's a fight that I have. The only thing in front of me right now is to get a win. I'm excited. I'm focused. I know what I need to do.
And you said this is the fight that you wanted. It was actually put together mutually by you and Forrest Griffin. What was it about this matchup that made you want to run it back again for what is your final UFC fight?
You know, I think it really comes down to the fights we had prior. They speak for themselves. It was probably the most exciting fights we had. And Forrest shows great heart. And someone to excel me to that level, I want to fight guys like that. I want guys to fight, run away from me and so forth. Guys who fight, and Forrest is a guy who fights.
And they were both close.
And they're both very, very close. And I don't know, on Saturday night, we're going to prove and see who the best guy is.
Now, you've said the three biggest highlights of your career, winning the world title versus Vanderlei Silva, tapping out Ryan Bader as a 5-1 underdog, and beating Ken Shamrock in the first big mega fight of the modern era. What do you believe, as you sit here right now, is your single greatest UFC accomplishment?
God, I'd say becoming the world champion. You know, a young punk kid who was on the street, who, you know, was around gangs, drugs, parents who were drug addicts. I wasn't except to be special in life, and I was worked hard and I dedicated myself. I became a world champion only after a year and a half of competition. I believed in being the best I possibly can be, and I became that. And I think I look back on my career right now, and that's the thing that stands out more than anything, because I was able to accomplish something that I was never supposed to do. And it shows what hard work and dedication can accomplish. And that's why I try to be an inspiration in people's lives. And that's when I changed my name from the bad boy to the people's champ, is to make a difference to every one of the humans on earth, man, that you can make a difference as long as you keep your mind focused and work hard. And that's what I've done.
Now, Dana White said a while back you were a lock to go into the Hall of Fame at some point. How much more special is it, though, to be inducted on the day of your final fight and to get to walk to the octagon one final time as a UFC Hall of Famer?
I haven't really thought about it. I've just been training. I've just been wanting to fight and just go out and do what I usually do. I don't know. The Hall of Fame is something that I'm very thankful, you know, for Dana and Lorenzo to induct me to this thing. It just shows to my fans that, you know, all my hard work does pay off, and I'm very thankful to it. And on Saturday, when I wake up that morning, I guess we're just going to have to tell how it all, you know, comes out, the outcome of it. But the most important thing right now to me is get in a cage and fight at the capacity that I know I can go fight at.
All right, Forrest Griffin, this is the third fight between you and Tito Ortiz. UFC 59, 2006, you lost a split decision. That was the fight of the year. Then you take the rematch also by split decision in 2009. But here as we sit in 2012, how closely are the two of you matched?
I don't think a lot's changed since the last couple go-rounds, you know. We'll see. I think, you know, you always think you have a couple surprises, but we'll find out.
All right, we know how competitive you are. We know your wit and sense of humor has endeared you to UFC fans across the world, but I'm going to ask you to take this question very seriously. You have said if you can't beat Tito Ortiz, you will retire from life. You're obviously have some pressure as the 4-1 favorite, but how much pressure are you putting on yourself to make sure you come through in this spot and to not let him go off into retirement by winning this series?
Well, shit, if I said it, it must be true. So there you go. I'll stand behind it. Tito said something that kind of spoke to me. He said, you know, this is, you know, I'll die for this. I will die for that. You know, and at first it sounds kind of outlandish, but if you really think about it, you know, in 20 or 30 years, if I'm remembered for anything, it's going to be for fighting. You know, I was never, you know, a soldier, a fireman, a cop, or, you know, I never put my life on the line in another capacity. This is the closest thing to being a hero I'll ever come. So yeah, I'll die for this. And I thought about that. I thought about that comment I made. I thought about what I was doing a long time ago when I started training for this fight. I thought this fight was going to be maybe May 5th, you know? So I'm ready. I've worked on a lot of new things. And, you know, I took it serious. I never really called anybody out before. You know, I never asked for an opponent before. So I figured if I was going to do that, I better make damn sure that I was ready.
All right. Well, you guys have already shared the octagon for 30 minutes. You know each other quite well. Can there be any surprises stylistically at this point in time? And what do you think when the octagon door closes, this fight's going to come down to?
Oh, yeah, that was for me. I don't know. You know, it's hard to say. That's kind of predictive analysis. You know, I know it's going to be a big day for Tito, and I know he's going to come in with a big head of steam. You know, Hall of Fame, final fight, fighting me. I know he gets motivated to fight me. You know, I just have to make sure that I'm prepared to match that intensity right from the jump.
All right, well, you are an established UFC veteran, obviously a former UFC champion, but this has been your first training camp as a father. How has that impacted your preparation and I guess affected, you know, the training camp and the days and weeks leading up to the fight?
Well, it's not that bad. I got a good wife, so.
Yeah, I think that goes a long way. All right,
I don't do any of the heavy lifting, you know?
You change diapers, though, right?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, all right, good. All right, Tito, we'll close with you here. 15-year career, so many memorable fights. It is down to its final 15 minutes. We know how badly you want to close this rivalry with a win. Can you put into words right now your level of motivation heading into the octagon Saturday night?
With great sacrifice comes great reward. I have sacrificed my body. I've sacrificed my mind. I sacrificed being away from my family for 9 weeks for this camp. For 15 years, I fought to get where I am today. Forrest is another fighter, bleeds like me, breaks like any other person. I'm going to do my job on Saturday night, and that's get a W.
All right, now we will welcome questions from the media on the floor. Once again, raise your hand. We will bring you a microphone, and please stand up when asking your questions.
This first one's for Tito. Tito, you've had four big rivals in the UFC. You got Frank Shamrock, Chuck Liddell, Dana White, and Forrest Griffin. Where does Forrest rank amongst those group of rivals that you've experienced in your Ultimate Fighting Championship career?
You know, it has to be the top two because it's true. You know, number one, of course, is Shamrock, because it was true. There was no lies. It was heartfelt towards each other. But it was a little different between Forrest. You know, me and Forrest, it was never really personal. It was, I never did any hatred towards him. You know, maybe the first fight I said a few things that were a little I wouldn't say not out of character, but out of trying to get under his skin. But I always respected Forrest. He's done great for the sport. He's done great for himself, becoming a world champion. And my third and final fight, you know, I asked Lorenzo and Dana if we could make this happen. You know, we both got split decisions, but, you know, I think me and Forrest's rivalry has to be the top two.
All right, one more. You're a very emotional fighter in and outside the octagon. On Saturday night, you're going to get introduced as UFC Hall of Famer Tito Ortiz. Is that going to affect you emotionally going into what is your last fight? It's the first time you fought. With knowing that there's not another fight after this, like just emotionally, how will you be able to handle that kind of situation?
Well, I think this kind of goes out when I almost won the middleweight world title against Frank Shamrock. I threw everything out. I have 15 minutes of me to go in 100% nonstop, 15 minutes. I ain't worried about no Hall of Fame. That's a give me. That's a guarantee. That's already, it's in the bag. What's not guaranteed is getting my hand raised. But in my mind, I'm focused. I'm positive reinforced myself to prepare what's going to happen, and that is to get my hand raised.
Richard Hunter Carroll, the Dallas, question for Tito. I'm wondering if you could sum up the second run here in the UFC. You know, going back to UFC 84, having to interview you in the hallway of the casino because you weren't being welcomed into the post-fight press conference, it seems hard to believe that you would ever be back in the UFC, let alone be on the eve of going into the Hall of Fame. Are you at peace with UFC management, with Dana White? And, you know, just if you can, sum up this second run that you've had in the UFC.
Well, I think it's just a reincarnation, you know. The hard work and everything has paid off. I've got the respect from the fans, from the company, and I've always been about UFC. I've seen a few interviews that Dana has done saying that I've always been about myself and so forth. It's kind of hard to say when I go and get back surgery to fight for the company, when I go get neck surgery to fight for the company, when I go get knee surgery to fight for the company. I've always been about this sport. I've always been about exposing this sport to its fullest potential. And its fullest potential being as we're the greatest athletes alive. We're the modern day gladiators. As you can see, I mean, all this fans and news and press, they're here for us. Because we are the modern day gladiators. We step out and we perform. And on Saturday night when I win, I'll win the crowd. And that's when I win my freedom.
My question's for Tito here. If you have to choose the five most important moments in your career, or fights, moments or fights, can you tell to us?
Five most important, wow. Number one's winning the world title, of course. Tied for first, beating Bader. Shamrock fight, the Frank Shamrock, when I lost to him, I learned a lot from that. Beating Ken. I say beating Forrest the first time.
Tito, I have a two-part question for you and one for Forrest. My name is Darren Smith with the Missouri State Post. Are you sure that this will be your last fight? Because you know a lot of athletes...
100%.
Okay, because you know a lot
I'll stop you right
have,
there. Nope. A lot of athletes ain't Tito Ortiz.
Okay.
I'm done.
All right,
yeah, so, I've done what I wanted to do.
That's good. And so what are your post-fight ventures? And then for Forrest, knowing one day that you're going to be hopefully get into the Hall of Fame, have you ever sat back and analyzed the importance of your fight with Stephen Bonner and the importance of what that fight meant to the UFC?
Go ahead, Forrest. I've already answered a bunch of them. Go first.
No, I mean, you know, in the middle of the journey, it's no time to kind of take a recollection of it. You know, you're still in it. You know, I have plenty of time for doing that later. I know the Stephen fight was big because people bring it up to me a lot. So it had to be big because people always still mention it a lot, you know.
My post-fight career, I don't know, maybe getting some commentating. You know, ESPN has offered me a job, but I would love to continue working with UFC. But I'm going to take a month off, go on vacation, enjoy life a little bit. 15 years, I've been sacrificing a lot. I've been away from my family a lot. And it's hard when you have children. You know, you watch the boys grow up, and all of a sudden they're 10 years old, 3 years old, and it's like, wow, years gone by so fast. And I don't want to be the father that my father was when he wasn't there because of drugs. I want to be there. That's why it's time for me to say bye.
Tito, back here. Rodrigo del Campo, LaCiudadDeportiva.com from Mexico. When you came into the UFC, Latin kids were into boxing, not MMA. Now that you're leaving, you have Joseph Benavides, you got Dominic Cruz, you got Cain Velasquez. That's part of your legacy. How do you feel?
I think I've done my job of, at least a part of my job, of trying to educate fans of what the sport is truly about. That we can be successful. Latinos can be successful. I wasn't supposed to be where I am today. I had three choices. Dead, in prison, or where I am right now. And I think I make some great decisions, and some great things have been given to me. You know, thanks to Dana, thanks to Lorenzo, and thanks for the UFC. I wouldn't be the man I am today if it wasn't for these things.
Thank you.
Case Kiefer, Las Vegas Sun. Couple more questions for Tito. Tito, aside from just the fight night experience, what do you think you're going to miss most about all this, and what do you think you're going to miss the least?
What I'm going to miss the least will be automatic training. It's hard, man. People don't understand how tough training is. Well, you've been doing it for 15 years. Yeah, the first 8 years is cool. 9 years is okay. 10 years, you're like, all right, this has been a decade. Damn. 14, you're like, all right. 15, you're like, okay, this is enough. Enough's enough. It's a full-time job. people think we get in the cage, we fight, and our day's over with, and we go and have happy family time and do, no. What we get paid for is to train. We fight for free. Training and what you put into training is what you get out of it. I know the things I probably miss the most is walking out, you know, feeling the energy of the fans, the electricity in the air. There's nothing like it at all. I mean, I've been on tour with some of the biggest rock bands in the world, Limp Bizkit and Korn, and I could sit there and when Jonathan Davis came out with Korn at the Thunderdome in Detroit, when 80,000 people were there, and I was sitting, I mean, this was after I fought Frank Shamrock, and I sat on the side of the stage with the Coors Light can, and he came walking out, and the crowd was so loud that my can was vibrating just by the echo of the voices. Had that same feeling when I walk out, there's nothing like it. It was like it was meant to happen. And I think that'll be one of the biggest things I'll miss is my fans in the crowd.
Speaking of training, a fight or two ago, I think you made a big deal of you stayed close to home. You said it helped you prepare. You've already mentioned you were in Big Bear for 9 weeks this time. What went into that decision? Why'd you decide to go back then?
I lose a little focus when I'm at home. You know, got my kids. I got my clothing company, Punishment Athletics. Got my gym, Punishment Training Center. My nutrition line, Punishment Nutrition. All that business stuff, I kind of had to put it on the back burner. You know, I left it up to my assistants and my friends to take care of my business partners and go up to Big Bear and focus strictly on this fight. Eat, sleep, and train. That's all I did. My family came up on the weekends, as you got to see on Fuel TV. Rededicate myself to something that I love. That's fighting.
And just lastly, you seem like you put your head down a little bit. Are you bothered by Forrest's retire from life comment?
No, not at all. That's his choice. He makes his own choices and his own decisions in life. And if I was known that seriously was about that, I would have bought him some retirement shoes.
Hi, Tito. I had a question regarding Chuck Liddell. You were supposed to fight him a third time, but you had to withdraw from that fight. Do you at all regret not being able to have that third fight?
If you had a chance of going paralyzed, would you take a fight?
No.
Is there any fight that you would have wanted to take that you didn't actually get?
Nah, I fought every one of my fights. Injured or not injured, I fought them. When a doctor told me I'd have a chance of being paralyzed, it's not worth $1 million. No possible way. And I got a bad image painted on me on that Ultimate Fighter, but we all know the truth. I mean, I had neck surgery. I came back and I fought Matt Hamill, who I coached, who was a tough-ass wrestler. And I took the fight on six months after neck surgery. I had C6, C7 fused in my neck. Athletes don't come back after that. That just shows how much I love the sport and how dedicated I am to my job and to the UFC.
Question for Forrest over here, straight ahead. Last time you fought, obviously, was in Brazil. You talked about not liking to travel. Do you think that you are a different fighter, a fighter who's in a better place when you get the fight at home? Do you feel the difference, especially on fight week?
Oh, yeah. I mean, fight week's pretty obvious. You know, you just go through your normal routine. Tonight, I'll work out at my normal gym at fight time. You know, it's other than this, it's pretty convenient.
And would you say, obviously, it's been a couple of years since you last fought Tito. Is he better, the same, or worse of a fighter since you last fought him, in your opinion, based on your scouting of him now?
That's a good question. You know, I think, I don't know. I thought, you know, you got to think, he fought Rashad. That was Rashad at his apex. You know, the Rashad he fought, that Rashad would have beat up a lot of guys. Pretty much everybody except that John Jones fella. But, you know, I don't know. I mean, I watched the fight with Hamill. He showed great striking there. You know, we'll see. I'd like to think, in my mind, I've prepared for every scenario. I think, you know, once we get going, though, it'll be the same kind of, you know, the same Tito, the same Forrest. I think, you know, we're both going to come in with game plans, and we'll see. You know, I kind of think it'll fall into the same rhythm it has. But I'm ready if it doesn't.
How about you, Tito? What do you think of Forrest? Better, worse, or the same?
I don't like you. I ain't answering your question, and Dan ain't here to save you, so. Next question.
John, come on. Let me have that. I just want to ask, can I ask you a follow-up? Maybe a better question?
I think that's a no.
John, are you going to stick up?
Next question.
No follow-ups?
I guess if he's not going to answer, we got to move on, my man.
That is unfortunate. Good luck to you, Tito.
Yeah.
This question is for El Bato Loco. He is Rafa from Univision Deportes. You talk about you're putting everything aside, your business, your family, and, you know, we spent a day up in Big Bear right after your son was ill. How difficult was it, Tito? Obviously, you know, how is he doing, and was the fight at risk of not happening after you got the news of your son?
You trying to make me cry, man? What the hell are you doing? Yeah, just kind of explain what he just, the question he had. My son had meningitis 3 weeks ago, and as a father, you don't understand how scary that is. I put my whole camp on, I literally got my car and I told my training guys, I'll be back. They're like, what do you mean be back? We got a big fight. I'm like, I'll be back. I got to take care of my family. I went to Arizona. Me and Jenna flew out there to see my son who had meningitis. Thank God my ex-wife Kristen caught it early enough. I'm very thankful for her for catching it early enough. It was viral. They were able to get rid of it in 3 days. Thank God he has Ortiz blood running through him. And he was able to bounce back super quick. And people don't understand how scary it is to lose a child until you have a child. People say, I love you. You don't know love until you have a kid. There's no love like it. And like I say, I put everything on hold. 4 days off, it was okay. I mean, I'm in great shape, so it wasn't a big deal. But I was just so thankful. I'm thankful for God, for the angels, or whoever was looking over my son and my family. I was destroyed, and it took me a day to kind of recover from it, but I was, to see a smile on his face, he had a little bit of a swollen face, but to see a smile on his face, saying, Dad, I'm glad you're here, and I was thankful, very, very thankful that my wife caught it when she did, or my ex-wife caught it when she did.
And we're happy he's doing okay, and a little Rosetta Stone, and you got a job at Univision Deportes también.
Right.
Forrest, you're a new father. How are you balancing this new experience? Obviously, you've been married for a while, but how are you balancing now somebody that is really depending on you and you having to deal with your kid and your training camp?
Yeah, I don't do much of the heavy lifting. You know, I had to, at one point I had to just move into the guest bedroom. You know, it's like, I'm not getting up and fighting dudes after waking up all night. So, you know, I think, you know, you have a good wife, you're going to be able to make it, you know. It's not easy. I wouldn't recommend having kids. It's not conducive to your career or your, you know, business, whatever.
I've got a question for you, Forrest. A couple things. First and foremost, whoever designed your T-shirt, bravo, genius. I want one. I'm curious. You're a very creative guy. You're a writer as well. You've been doing your tweeting therapy. I know that's going well for you. I'm curious, when you're training, though, how does that affect your writing? Does it make, is it a better outlet for you creatively? You know, do you write more when you're in camp or less?
No, I got a ton of crap for the third book, and I put it on hold a while back, and I'll pick it up again Monday.
A question for Tito over here. Tito, going away party on Saturday, how different do you think the sport would be if you had not been there?
I've never thought of that one. I don't know. There may have been another Tito Ortiz. My name would have been Tito Ortiz, but I don't know. I just tried to do my job as well as I possibly can do. That was to try to educate the fans and bring attention to the sport, but in a good manner. And I think I've done that. And then Forrest, I mean, he's done the same thing too with the Ultimate Fighter. I mean, he's showed what us fighters have in heart. I don't know. I never thought about it if there was no Tito Ortiz in the UFC. This is my calling, I think. This is what I was supposed to do. This is setting the stars for me. God had a plan for me. I'm not done yet, but this was part of it.
Well, I know I speak for all MMA fans in the world. Thank you for all the memories.
Without a doubt, man. I appreciate you. Thank you.
Forrest, I do have a little girl. It's not so little anymore, but do you think she motivates you to fight more now or to maybe retire?
No, not at all. That retirement, that's been going around. Apparently, when you joke about suicide, people think you might quit your job. He was talking earlier about training. I really like training. Like, after I got beat up by Silva, I was pretty depressed, and this weird thing happened. Every day, I just got in my car, and it went to the gym. And no matter what I'm doing in life, that just seems to happen. You know, even if I don't intend to, my car goes right to the gym, and I work out. I don't know. I just really enjoy work. You know, I don't mind it. It's not something I'm ready to give up yet. You know, you get a little, you have setbacks and you get disappointed. And my frustration with this sport simply comes from me not being able to be better than I am. You know, me working on things and then not doing them. I had a great camp for Shogun. I was in great shape, yada, yada, yada. Fought like shit. You know, it's upsetting, you know? It's not, I love this sport. I work about twice a year, and every time after I fight, I usually take a month off. Last time, I had a kid, so I took 6 weeks off. So, I don't know, I mean, I like training camps. It's fun to me, you know, it's a good reason to get out of bed in the morning. You gotta do something, you know? You gotta get out of bed and do something, and wrestle around with dudes is what I wanna do.
One last question for Tito. Tito, is there anyone in the MMA media particularly that you're going to miss?
Wow. I know all of them. Everybody in the media has always been really good to me. You know, I've always gone out of my way to help people make their careers on media. I've always been very media friendly. I've done interviews outside of UFC to help. And some people have showed their true colors, and some people are still with me. And I don't know, I'm not done yet. You know, I still be along the sport. You know, UFC has given so much for me to be here. I'm not turning my back on it. It's like all of a sudden, okay, Tito's done, I'm retired. Later, guys, thank you for the money. I appreciate it. Thanks for the career. No, I'm here. I'm still working. I'll still be working. I know either it's with Fox and UFC, ESPN. I'll be doing something in the sport no matter what. We still have millions and millions of fans across the world to educate on the sport, what it truly is. And I'm not done yet.
All right, one more media question, and then we'll get a few from the fans here in attendance.
Conor Cordova, MMA Weekly. This question is for Tito. Tito, you spent the majority of your career being the bad boy, the Huntington Beach bad boy. Now I see a very focused and at peace Tito Ortiz. Was this just very much a journey that brought you to this point? Was there one moment of true clarity that is making you what you are today?
You know, I think the bad boy was so negative, and negative will consume you. Before the Bader fight, I got sick of people talking smack. I got sick of people judging me in the company, outside the company, that would have an image on me that I really wasn't. And it hurt, because I'm a sensitive cat. I mean, I've gone through a lot, and to change to the people's champ was in a positive manner. To show people that you're able to get through anything, any adversities in life. I've had back surgery, I've had neck surgery, I've had ACL replacement. I've had things done to me that athletes don't compete after. And I just want to show what hard work and dedication can achieve. And when I got out of that bad boy image, I think it really came about to being in a positive limelight for my children, to show that their father is a true champion. And he's worked hard in the sport to help get it where it is today. I'm thankful for Lorenzo, for Tita, Frank Fertitta, Dana White, for giving me the job I've had in 2001 when they bought this company. They kind of put it on my shoulders. You know, I remember in 2003, I was sitting down with Frank Fertitta and Lorenzo, and they said, we're sick of spending money. I said, just hold on to this, man. This sport's going to be huge. Just hold on to it. And year after year after year, they got on the Ultimate Fighter when Forrest was on season. He was one of the guys who helped save the sport. He got the interest back there again, where it was like mainstream media got that attention. And we've been a snowball effect since then. And not only here in the United States, but worldwide. I mean, I think we're the number three in the sport entertainment world, behind soccer, behind basketball. We've taken over boxing, that wasn't a problem. We've taken over professional wrestling, that wasn't a problem. Taken over NFL, our next goal now is to conquer soccer and conquer basketball. And I think Dana has that job in front of him to achieve those things to make it happen. And I think he can with those fighters that really have done it.
Well, thank you for your legacy, Tito. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right, so we have a few questions from some fans, and then we'll get these guys squared up for some photo ops. They're bringing those microphones around.
It's not really a question. I just wanted to thank Tito for everything you did for the sport, for always representing La Raza. Thank you.
De nada. Muchas gracias por el apoyo.
My name is Jaden Mueller. I am from Denver, Colorado, and I'm 11 years old. Knowing what you did for the sport, Forrest, what advice can you give us young fighters out there to succeed?
Best advice I always give people, wrestle in high school, wrestle in middle school. Learn how to not only wrestle, but you learn how to, you learn what a practice is supposed to feel like. You learn how pushing yourself is supposed to feel. You know, I never wrestled. I regret that, obviously. But fortunately, I was in team sports, and I learned how you're supposed to feel at the end of a practice. I learned how you drill. I learned how you get annoying when you're doing reps of things. And I think that's kind of, you know, that's what a sport like high school sports brings to, you know, brings to your life, is you learn how to discipline yourself and you learn what you're looking for and what you need to do to get better. So, wrestle in high school or middle school or wherever.
Thank you.
Hey, Tito, I'm in the back here. Just wanted to know, I know you you have the punishment clothing over here, Tito. Got the walkout shirt. Wanted to know if you're going to update it after after the win and the time in the octagon after this fight.
I just might. Right. I don't know. I don't know how the time's going to end on this one. Yeah, I will. Of course I will.
And what's your prediction as far as...
I predict a great fight. Predict a war.
Thanks, Tito.
All right, got time for one more fan question.
Hey, Tito. Tito over here. Hey, hey, I'm Sergeant Melendez. I just want to say on behalf of the troops, I know that you're not a big, you don't really talk about it. You always take your flag out. You wear it on your sleeve, and I know that you visited Iraq. I don't know if you've been to Afghanistan. I know Faber's been to Afghanistan. Penn's been to Afghanistan. In behalf of all soldiers, past, current, future, from the bottom of my heart, I want to thank you. So.
Thank you, man. Since 2001, I've been walking out with the flag, or 2002 when I've been walking out with the flag, and I haven't stopped. I've been to Iraq, actually, five times. I was one of the first UFC fighters to go over there just to show respect to our troops, men and women who support our country. If it wasn't for them, we wouldn't have beautiful 4th of July that we did yesterday.
All right, a good note on which to end. That's going to do it from here. In 2 days' time, UFC 148 emanates from Las Vegas, headlined by the Cosmic Showdown between Anderson Silva and Chael Sonnen. And don't forget, the pay-per-view begins Saturday night at 10 p.m. Eastern. We appreciate you all being here and tuning in. The fighters will now square off for some photos. We will begin, actually, I guess we'll begin with Tito and Forrest. And we're going to bring Patrick and Cung out here.